camera. So you'll see yourself on the screen. Hey, hello, hello, hello.
Greetings and salutations, everyone. You have once again turned into Networking for Success. I'm your host, Walt Lusk. And of course, in studio always is the world-renowned and famous author and
me,
entrepreneur extraordinaire. I'm trying to get the words out. John Dade.
Me. Hi. How you doing? Well, thanks again, Walt. This is John Dade here. Welcome to a new installment of Networking for Success radio show. I'd like to start off with just a little bit about me before we get into the topic and have some fun here. Multi-licensed financial professional with High Ridge Futures and Family Wealth Leadership. Basically, we offer alternative and traditional investment strategies to investors looking for something a little bit different. Also, the founder of a networking group called Cigar Night Business Mixer Group. We have chapters in L.A., San Diego, Orange County. We just launched our chapter in Westlake Village in the Valley on October 23rd.
It was a great inaugural meeting.
Awesome.
It was at a Bentley Rolls-Royce dealership.
Bentley's Rolls-Royce dealership had almost 100 people there.
Was that all? I thought it looked like more.
Well, in and out. It was in and out. There was more, but you know, we capped at about 100.
That's great.
Matter of fact, we're going to be there tonight after the show. We're heading up there to the Malibu Cafe for the second evening of the event. So, also author of the book, Is Your Networking Networking? And basically, it's a how-to guide to build your business, to build your connections, build relationships through networking. And in this case, a whole different level based on cigars and scotch and bourbon and rum and tequila. And today, vodka.
Vodka.
Vodka. And we're happy to have with us today as our special guest, Mr. Sam Chereskin, the mad scientist, as they say, behind a great and unique product called Misadventure Vodka. And we're going to talk about that a little bit.
It's kind of an amazing, amazing story. I had the privilege of the last cigar mixer
we had
in Orange County.
Yes.
And fun stuff.
Fun
great
stuff.
Stuff.
Thank you very much.
Amazing
great
story.
Stuff. Thank you both.
Sure.
You're in sales. I'm in sales. We already know that people in sales need to keep the pipeline full, keep things moving forward, you know, networking, making calls, finding new prospects. So how do you make that more productive and easier?
Before we delve that, if I might just take a little
deep. Yeah.
This is the 11th chapter of John's book.
Wow. Yes.
And it's entitled?
It's entitled, It's Not What You Know, But Who Knows You.
Who knows you, correct.
And that's based on a quote
there
in the beginning of the chapter. It's by Bob Berg. He's an author of Endless Referrals and The Go-Giver. And the quote is this. It isn't just what you know, and it isn't just who you know. It's actually who you know, who knows you, and what you and they know what you do for a living. I think that's very important. So,
couldn't agree more.
Absolutely. So today, again, our special guest, Sam, is with us. And thank you. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
I came all the way up. We're in Burbank, folks, okay, so you can get this geographically.
Beautiful downtown Burbank.
Beautiful downtown Burbank, right across from WB Studios.
Warner Brothers.
And Sam drove up all the way from San Diego, God love him, in the rain, in our traffic.
We don't have that very often.
So, we had to explain what rain is, but we'll get to that later.
Some form of water.
So, yeah, it's water. Now, since you brought water up, that's a great segue into what you do. Misadventure vodka. Insane. Tell me about it. For what it's worth,
my product's only 60% water.
60% water.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That means it's pretty
It's 40% something else.
Pretty, wow, 40%. Tell us about that something else.
Sure.
Welcome.
Thank you. So Misadventure Vodka is the first vodka in the world to be made from excess baked goods. We'll take 2,000 pounds right now per batch of everything you've ever imagined in a grocery store bakery aisle, and all at once, without a recipe, turn it into vodka so that doesn't go to waste.
That includes rye bread and sourdough bread and everything?
Everything. My favorites to talk about are jalapeno cheese bagels, garlic bread, cheesecake. The absolute majority is your standard wheat flour-based pastry or bread,
mm-hmm.
But it goes anywhere and everywhere.
So you're saying this is healthy for you?
It's definitely better for the environment. I don't know about your liver or anything
Wow,
else.
I'm going to start drinking more of that. I'm getting my daily dose of vitamins and minerals.
Is it gluten-free?
It is. It is. We put that on the label.
It's gluten-free?
As verified by the U.S. Treasury Department.
There it is.
Hedonistic sustainability.
Yeah, share with that. We've updated the catchphrase from hedonistic sustainability to the spirit of sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
But the tone that underwrote those first two words, it's going to stick with the company forever. It's why it exists. We wanted make doing good economically viable. And in so doing, particularly in consumer packaged goods, we needed to make a product that, in our case, had an environmental message, something we believed in,
mm-hmm.
had a price that people actually wanted to transact on,
mm-hmm.
whereas in most cases, there's a 50% surcharge across industries for anything that does good while also serving a function. And then
you think?
Yeah, and then we also wanted it to be fun. And in this case, because we're in distilled spirits, its functional benefit is its fun.
Mm-hmm.
So the mix of price, cause, and fun is what we originally called hedonistic sustainability. We borrowed it from, I believe, Danish architect, Bjarke Ingels. He coined the phrase in order to talk about within design, when building something from the ground up, you don't have to assume that these things are polar opposites,
mm-hmm.
goodness, utility, and fun.
Mm-hmm.
But in many cases we have.
And you mentioned building it from the ground up. I know I've talked with you and your partner, Whitney.
Mm-hmm.
This was so unique that you actually had to create and build unique distilling equipment and what have you to produce this product. Tell a little bit about that.
Sure. So, starting with the craft brewing boom over the last 20, 25 years, a lot of people have started making alcohol, and there was seemingly this natural transition into distilled spirits.
Mm-hmm.
You would think that as wine liberalized in the 70s and 80s, and then 90s and 2000s saw beer come around, that distilled spirits might be the next logical place for the craft movement to
go. Makes sense.
What we found was that vodka in particular is a difficult product for craft distillers to make. You end up needing a very special ratio of height and width in order to be able to do two things. That ratio, if it's relatively narrow but still relatively tall, will make vodka. I'll get into why this is different.
Can you expand what that means? What do you mean when you say height and width?
Sure. So for a column on a still, at any point when we're distilling anything, we're boiling mm-hmm. the alcohol out of the water alcohol solution.
Right. So you have the base of the still that's boiling mm-hmm. kind of the pot, the cauldron.
Right.
Okay.
And so in order to then recollect this vapor,
mm-hmm.
We'll condense it, but in the middle, you've got some kind of design.
Mm-hmm.
The column that this vapor is rising up that you haven't let just escape into the world,
mm-hmm.
the design of that column determines what kind of spirit it's going to make.
Ah, okay.
And so,
whether it's a straight up column or a slanted column or a column with a bubble in the middle kind of thing? Or
those are all part and parcel of what I'm talking mm-hmm. about, but in the transition between what most in my industry call neutral spirits to traditional ones,
mm-hmm.
traditional being the ones that you've talked about being an avid fan of so many times, mm-hmm. tequila, rum, whiskey of all sorts,
mm-hmm.
these things still have a flavor of the thing that they came from, whereas neutral spirits in my industry's vernacular doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the base ethanol that would go into making either vodka or gin.
Okay.
In order to be able to make multiple different types of spirits, a lot of craft distillers will get some kind of hybrid, something mm-hmm. that will be able to make it a higher ABV than your typical traditional brandy still or the alambic with the pot that you've seen
mm-hmm.
up on top, but still not as pure a rectifier as is able to make 95% ethanol or pure ethanol outside of a vacuum.
Okay.
And so a lot of these craft distillers can probably get their ABV up to about 93%.
AVB.
Alcohol by volume. So okay. One half of proof. The background on proof, if in the day you wanted to prove that your alcohol was worth being sold or purchased, you could pour your alcohol on gunpowder, and it just happened to be a historical quirk that 50% ABV, alcohol by volume, still lit, whereas 49 didn't.
Interesting.
And so 50 ABV was 100% proof that it was still good alcohol, and that just kind of turned into the 200 proof scale that we have. But by the time a lot of these craft distillers have a still that can make
I knew there's a link between shooting and firearms and gunpowder and alcohol somewhere.
There has to
okay.
be.
And then, there's the phrase, keep your gunpowder dry.
Yeah, unless it's with 50 or above proof.
Okay. Then it still lights.
Sorry to interrupt, but that's what we do here.
Yeah. So we get to this point where most craft distillers can make something that still has more flavor than a vodka should. Mm-hmm. They can get up to maybe about 93. Those last 2% sound like it would be a small difference, but in the physical design of this thing, it becomes much larger or much more specialized in order to get that 2 or 3% back. Mm-hmm. And so for us, now that we've figured out that we needed to make neutral spirit for our special project of making the world's bakery excess turn into another valuable product with an infinite shelf life.
Wow.
We had to come up with a way to do it. In order to get those last 2 to 3%,
there you go.
You have a certain width of the column that you're boiling this vapor up relative to a certain height. So our columns, say, are 4 inches wide, but are 12 to 15 feet tall. And that's much taller than most craft stills.
Right.
The second problem is that when you only have a 4-inch column, without giving away everything about what I've designed, since we did do it ourselves.
Trade secrets ahead.
But the question then for the craft distillers, once you finally made a product, how do you make enough of it to actually turn it into a business as opposed to a hobby?
Well, no, I want to know if you could put a 12, you know, loaf of bread in there. I mean, you know, if it's 4 inches.
Well, I mean, we can. We put 2,000 pounds of bread in there.
So, no, that'll plug things up.
So at that point, we had to design our own
equipment. Pop goes the bagel?
Design our own equipment in order to be able to solve both of those problems at
once. He's trying to keep a straight face.
One of the other distilleries in San Diego, Cutwater, for example, when they spun off of Ballast Point in order to make their vodka, they were able to purchase their building and build a 6-story atrium in order to house the largest still on this side of the Mississippi. This side of the Mississippi. As a startup with just seed capital, we weren't able to build the same kind of infrastructure.
Sure.
So instead, we had to be able to innovate our way through the problem of not being able to puncture our own roof, but still wanting to make vodka. Yeah.
Well, you guys are young. I mean, you're a young guy. Whitney is a young guy. And, you know, you come up with this. You're the typical entrepreneur spirits. Keeping with some of the themes that we're talking about, it's not what you know, because you obviously have your background and distillery chops, you know, well honed. But what about who you know and who knows you? How did you bring this together? I mean, you woke up and said, "Gee, we want to do this." Who out there did you know, and more importantly, knew you well enough to say, "Okay, let's talk about this and see if we can make it happen"?
You know, I give a lot of credit to our acting CFO. Whitney and I came together with this idea that we wanted to make whiskey and whiskey only. I currently, when people ask whether we're ever going to do it, refer to that joke about whether or not McDonald's is a food company or actually a real estate company that just happens to serve food.
Real estate company. happens to serve food.
I saw the movie. It's a real estate company. Yeah.
The cost structure of making aged spirits is so wickedly different that when we went to the angel market and said, "We're two first-time entrepreneurs, and we'd like $4 million, but you won't be able to even taste whether we've made a prototype for 2 years," the answer was obviously a bunch of no's.
Yes.
It was my background that allowed us, in trying to add value to food systems, that allowed us to pivot. But within those first couple meetings with angels who all said no, they asked, "Who's your CFO?" My answer at the time, naively, was, "I guess myself." At that point, Whit and I had put together a 118-page business plan, spent the last 4 years doing 100 different yeast experiments, and never, ever distilling without a license, of course.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Wink, wink. Okay.
Depends on the viewership.
In my understanding, angel investors, they always prefer three anyway. Because if something happens to one, there's still two to fall back on. Because if there's just two.
Founders?
Yes, founders. Founders. Yeah. Because if there's two founders, if something happens to one of them, then there's a huge impact and it might impact the whole investment. Where if it's a three, you've got a little more.
A little backup.
A little more backup.
Well, as much as that prototypical case may be true, that case study didn't apply to us. It was just the two. So we, the guy asked, do you have a CFO? I said no, and he, without asking anything further, put me in touch with our CFO now, Jim Good. And when Jim originally called me, I thought I was being hard sold something that I didn't want.
It's understandable.
I took the lunch meeting with Whit, and I thought I was just going to get some fish tacos out of it and maybe learn something. But it was immediately apparent that this man could help us. And in this case, it was in structuring a two fundraising rounds in order to be able to raise the amount of money needed to be able to go from an idea through seed round through Series A and to permanent profitability. We didn't have that level of sophistication on our own. The next reason I thank him is because he started putting us in touch with his network of professionals. He's an older gentleman relative to us, and therefore had years of the networking reality that you espouse, whereas we were green. The 118-page business plan that we put on everyone's desk, I don't think a single person read it.
It's a lot of pages.
I mean, it was incredibly valuable to us, but it was its major purpose, it seemed, at that time, was just being like a testament to the amount of work that we had done to this point.
Mm-hmm.
And what we ended up being able to translate that early moment into was being able to work with a caliber of professional that would otherwise have been impossible to work with. They all deferred fees. They all found ways
to make it happen.
To be able to make this happen.
Mm-hmm.
And for it, we've had a phalanx of incredibly talented people helping us try to be the best version of ourselves in this company.
Wow.
So, I mean, that's my original answer. Mm-hmm. Part of it was dumb luck. Part of it was a lot of work. And part of it was when people finally learn your name, being able to signal to them quickly enough that they understand that you may be worth something.
What we said in the book, who knows you?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I mean, you have a great background in the industry, but unless they knew who you are, you know, it's not going to put a bottle on the shelf.
Sure.
And speaking of which, you know, we might as well crack this puppy open.
I think we should.
Sample a little bit while we're at it.
The bottle, if you look at it, is really cool. It is actually focus on you,
Joe. I don't know if I get it.
It's a wine bottle.
Yeah.
And would love to know, I mean, in addition, you're going to expound upon the name, Misadventure.
Absolutely.
But, vodka and a wine bottle.
And again, on the back is a hedonistic sustainability, but their catchphrase is, saving the world is worth a shot. And we're going to find out right now.
Thank you.
There it is.
Now we'll pour up and run it from here.
Chair, as many fingers as you're willing to do.
The vodka was actually at the last Orange County meeting, and I've had it. It's really good.
Thank you.
Yeah, and it's filtered 12 times.
Distilled 12 times. Distilled 180.
Excuse me. Filtered 180. Okay, but it's distilled 12 times. But I want to know how you came up with 12 and not 11 or 13.
Because it's an even number, and 13 we know.
I actually think it is 13, and
oh no,
it wasn't lucky enough, so we drop it down.
Okay.
The wine bottle came from us wanting to originally put our bourbon in reused wine bottles.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to give it a French name. It was going to be called Ceci. Cheers, everybody.
By the way, yeah, cheers, everybody. Salute.
Salute.
So... I was going to give it a French name, name it after that Magritte painting with the pipe. This is not a pipe. Ceci n'est pas une pipe.
Mm-hmm.
This was going to be Ceci n'est pas du vin. This is not wine. It was probably too avant-garde for wide release, so we didn't go that way. But we stuck with the wine bottle aesthetic, first for cost of goods, but second, it spoke to us at that time about how we wanted to emphasize the quality of what was in the packaging and not the packaging itself.
Okay.
It's a difficult prospect in the alcohol industry. Packaging is very important. But by the time we actually had to switch back, we were about to launch Misadventure Vodka for the first time. We had 20 things to do, and 19 of them were about the bottle project, trying to find these reused wine bottles. As opposed to being able to go to institutional aggregators like food banks and pick up all the baked goods we want, mm-hmm. we would end up going, we would have to go to every wine drinker in the state in order to find them before they're broken. So we, with 19 to 1 left on our to-do list, we dropped the 19 and just did the 1. But we kept the green glass wine bottle that we were originally going to use. We, at this point, like that it stands out.
Mm-hmm.
We
of course.
Like that it's different. We like that it has a story behind it and at least a history as to why we did it. But there's no, I have no apologies whatsoever for having a bottle that, even though it's relatively available,
mm-hmm.
It's not some custom bottle. You put it on a shelf with all frosted, clear, and blue glass vodkas, it stands out.
That's a fact, because you expect to see vodkas because they talk about crystal clear, crystal clear, crystal mm-hmm. clear, mm-hmm. and everything there is crystal clear, different shapes, different sizes, and everything. Mm-hmm. This is going to stand out, and people are going to go, what? You know, well, the bottle's a misadventure, and there it is. You know?
Yeah.
It reminds me of the story, if I can digress, with Paul Mitchell.
Mm-hmm.
They were literally living out of their cars and trying to sell their hair care products, and they didn't have any money for colored graphics.
That makes mm-hmm. perfect sense.
Yep.
And so they only had the money for black and white, and in retrospect, it stands out.
It was genius. Yep.
And
was genius.
In hindsight, it was brilliant. But yeah, they said, we didn't have any money for color, so we just came... Just use black and white in Paul Mitchell.
That sounds so familiar.
Mm. Yeah, true story. I heard it from Paul Mitchell himself.
There you go. There you go. And I mean, it sounds like, you know, and again, in Chapter 11, we talk about building the network and why you build the network and the advantages of building a network and some of the perks of building the network. And you certainly touched on those. And we're going to touch on some more. I'm going to, mm-hmm. you know, ask you to jump in. And we don't. We don't raise our hands. Just jump in as the mood fits, you know, sees fit, right?
I will definitely do
good.
So.
Yes.
We're interested. Thank you.
And again, it's about building a circle of friends and prospects and clients. And in my industry, you know, which is alternative investments,
mm-hmm.
the networking group became a necessity because of the type of client I needed to meet.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the group are a group of CPAs, trust attorneys, independent advisors. And these are things that I can network with. I can refer, they can refer, and build relationships with to help grow the business. And we talk about the need to build your own networking group. And if you don't want to have that, you know, if you don't want to build your own networking group, have that ambition, okay, the group that you're in, you know, take and become more active in that and more vital in that and come up with ideas and be creative. And you might be able to change the flavor of the group a little bit more to your liking and make it work a little bit more for you. I know when we started ours, again, we're 9 years going on 10 years in February next year. And in the beginning, it was 8, 9, 10 people, but the word started getting out. And one of the best validations for the group at the time is we were approached. A lot of different people came, and you know, politicians, things like that, to check it out. And the county approached us, the county supervisors, about being part of a group to raise goods, personal miscellaneous items for the veterans over, I believe it was Afghanistan.
It was Iraq.
Iraq, okay.
That's a story in the book.
Yeah, it's in the book, okay.
It's Iraq.
There's so many going on right now, yeah. I just kind of put my finger on one.
Iraq.
So to make a long story short, I was also a classic Corvette owner, so I knew a bunch of the Corvette groups. So we jumped in with both feet, our cigar networking group, and we coined it Vets for Vets, you know, Corvettes for Vets. And we had, on the day of the event, about 30 vintage Corvettes, ranging from the early 50s up through the latest model at that time was 2010, in the parking lot for people to check out and review. People brought
personal items, toiletries and soap and chewing gum and playing cards and whatever we could bring to ship to the troops overseas, and cigars. You bought a box of cigars, you donated it. We shipped a little over 300 pounds of goods to the troops overseas, including cigars and all the things I mentioned above. And it was a great event. Everybody had a great time. We felt good giving back. We didn't send any Misadventure Vodka, but
wasn't around yet.
Wasn't around then.
Did spirits get sent over there?
Huh?
Did spirits get sent over? When you sent stuff to Iraq, was spirits sent over?
Oh no, not that I know of. I don't know anything. but what was very, I mean, it was a great time. We felt good about it. Got accommodations from these supervisors, things like that for our group. But the most important and fun thing that we got was a few weeks later, we got a picture back from the troops, about 20 of them gathered, with a banner from Orange County, a flag from Orange County, all of them with a cigar in their hand or in their big, grinny, toothy smile.
That's awesome.
That was very gratifying. We had a great time with that. So, and yours, I mean, you're out there. Do you go to the different stores and you bring the product to there and let people taste it and try it? I know you've come to our events.
Yeah. So your events were introduced to me through networking.
Mm-hmm.
We were doing the long story was we were doing a roadshow at Costco, and a woman came by and nicely heard our story, bought a bottle, and said, "You should meet my brother." The brother happened to be a broker and came to visit our distillery, and then maybe 18 months later, as we've stayed in touch, put me in, Whit and I in touch with you, and that's how that worked.
Wow.
So it took three different touch points in order for us to meet,
and mm-hmm.
it took maintaining relationships for that long in order for a beneficial interaction mm-hmm. to still come of it.
Well, that's the whole thing. It's about building relationships, and that's how things are done.
Absolutely.
Nowadays, especially after the 80s and then the crash in 2008. I mentioned this on a couple of the shows. People don't like to be sold. They don't like to be pushed. They keep their cards close to their chest now. There's just so much uncertainty out there.
Yep.
So it's about building relationships. And you mentioned a point, three points of contact.
Mm-hmm.
That brings value to a networking group. Mm-hmm. when somebody comes back and that tells me that we're doing something right.
Yeah. You were incredibly welcoming on that first meeting when I was able to attend. When Whit came, he came back with glowing reports as well. Thank you for the cigar.
Oh, my pleasure.
And it's been incredibly good. Thank mm-hmm. you.
Yeah. Excellent. Now, we're certainly going to have you back, in 2020 if you can fit it in your schedule. We'll talk more about that afterwards. But it's just when things like that happen and we meet, and we get a chance to be introduced to a new product,
mm-hmm.
a new spirit, or a new cigar. I happen to be sitting with the my father, Florida Antilles, one of my favorite cigars. Thank you, my father, cigars. But there's a lot of perks that go along with the networking group that we built. And one of those is being invited to different events.
Mm-hmm.
And I talk about it in Chapter 11. A friend of mine is part of the networking group. He happens to travel a lot and be somewhat politically active and do different things. And we'll make this as short as possible, but he was invited to a networking event. I mean, not a networking event. An event for the past president of Mexico, Vicente Fox.
Mm-hmm.
And he invited me to go along. Vicente Fox was going to be there. They were going to interview him. They were doing some kind of event. I'm not quite sure what it is because I didn't end up going. I wanted to go. Had a client issue. They come first, so I missed mm-hmm. the event. But we stayed in touch and what have you. And Vincente's publicist, we contacted him. And, we ended up meeting with him. And he's a big cigar fan, obviously. And we ended up sitting down and actually interviewing him for, an issue of Cigar and Spirits magazine. I don't have that one with me because it was a couple of years back. But we interviewed him for Cigar and Spirits magazine. He was a gracious guest. So, again, it's about second, third, fourth party contacts. But keeping that relationship going, building that relationship, keeping things warm.
May I share an anecdote?
Jump in.
So this one's not so much about keeping things warm. This one's about...
This isn't going to be something we have to censor, is it?
No, it's just okay. the importance of actually showing up.
That's important.
Yeah, it seems so basic, but there's so many good intentions in the world. Mm-hmm. And so there's only a certain amount of follow-through, but it's less than the good intentions.
Mm-hmm.
There are any number of networking groups that already exist within all of our domains. Obviously, we only have 24 hours in a day. Obviously, we only go to a few, if any. Mm-hmm. As a young entrepreneur, the CEO of my own company, I once had a doctor ask, so you keep talking about a lot of work hours. How often do you work? I said, well, I basically have the same length of shift as you do, but I don't have 4 days off in between. So 16-hour days are a little bit above median.
Mm-hmm.
So being able to get to these events is sometimes hard. But sometimes it just pays off. This one, they almost never work this way. But one of our most fortuitous meetings, I was lost. The GPS for the networking event said I was supposed to be directly in the middle of a fountain. And I obviously wasn't. There were three other people there, though, who were also lost in the middle of the fountain.
Mm-hmm. You know, there's stories on YouTube about people actually driving the rivers because they're just following GPS.
Sure.
It says, go here. I went. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, so we, the three of us end up bonding over the fact that we're lost. I end up getting into a stranger's car thinking, well, I'm either going to find my way to the networking event or I'm going to have one hell of a story. And
could be both.
Long story short, the woman who was driving the car knew about what we did. Without me having brought it up, she asked the question, what do you do? I said, I make a vodka, and told her how. She said, is it Misadventure? Yeah, I already own a bottle. So to your point, they need to know what you do.
Mm-hmm.
And now her husband's on our board.
There you go.
Wow.
So
that is, I mean, I love these stories because they just validate the fact that, again, even if you don't have your own networking group, the fact that you're networking, the fact that you're
that's
out
it.
There,
but
the
that's
fact
the
that you're
only
connecting.
Time I ever went to that networking group.
Mm-hmm.
I, for the success rate, 100% on a really high amplitude,
yes.
I should definitely go back. There was one moment that still makes me chuckle, though. I found out that I was the only person in that room who didn't do yoga. I found out by show of hands.
Or lack of hands.
Well, okay, then in that case, it makes two of us. Okay.
Yeah, so I mean, within the environmental, it makes more sense that I make an environmental product. We mm-hmm. haven't even talked about the fact that it is carbon negative, which I'm very proud of. But so I'm at a social, I don't remember the name of the group, something like social capitalism, where like it's about business, it's for business owners, but people who also want to make sure that their business does good.
Ah,
and
unique twist on that again.
I like that. I think you should go back.
I think you should go back.
So, but the yoga thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, bring a yoga mat and fake it.
I mean, come on, downward dog is in the heart.
Sure, and I. As
so
far
I was running
as,
late, folks. I my yoga class went over.
Sure. As far as just bringing a yoga mat and faking it, I think that's the same as any intro class in Southern California, anyway.
Oh, okay.
So
probably.
I mean, everyone according to these people, everyone I've ever met does yoga now, except for me. So there's got to be a scale.
There's got
to
be a scale.
To say that some are yogis and some are not.
I think we should have an investigation. Get the attorney general involved. And I think we should have a hearing.
I think we should leave it to an internet poll at best.
As my mother used to say, given your little misadventure, is that for example, David Crockett and Daniel Boone were never lost, but they were bewildered for a couple of days.
Oh, perfect.
Oh, I love that play on words, yeah. And that misadventure just happened to pay off for you, right?
It did. Yeah, got in a stranger's car. So Mom said never do that.
It was destiny. It was destiny.
Come on, strangers are only people I haven't met yet.
That's fair. It is anecdotally so much more fun to acknowledge that as an adult than it would be as a child.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. More ways than even
now,
one.
That's a whole different show.
Yeah, it's a different show.
It's a entirely different show.
Nursery rhymes only.
Exactly. So how did you come up with the, I mean, you said when at the cigar event, hey, we had a lot of misadventures, and so therefore come up with the name Misadventure, because obviously that's a far cry from some French spirit that you were going to use.
Some of it was practical. So I think anyone who starts a business will have to live through the naming phase and understanding that if you are going to try to trademark it, you need to find one that isn't already taken.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, you just assume that burden. Find one that isn't taken and that works for your company. We took so many twists and turns in order to get to where we are now, from the want to make bourbon to any number of the tactical difficulties that happens on any given day, that the path that we've taken is definitely how Wit and myself relate to Misadventure. I think there are probably two others. The one that he quotes most often is very people-centric.
Mm-hmm.
The way I phrase it is that with the people that you care the most about or enjoy the most, you may have won an award, but you don't tell them just that. You tell them how you tripped on the way to the podium, the humanizing stories of mm-hmm. the ones of imperfection. The last one for me from an environmental standpoint is that none of us have lived through this environmental moment before. It sounds like a misadventure to me.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, we don't come out of it alive.
No. So that's why I'm safe in saying it.
Well, I mean, to take that tack, I mean, it's, and I've been, you know, drinking a few years longer than you have, and come across a lot of different spirits. And this is the first one I've come across that has that background, that history, that story, that carbon neutral.
Negative.
Negative.
I can explain that too.
Footprint.
Please do.
It tastes good too.
It's good stuff.
It has a flavor. It's hard to describe the flavor of this, folks, until you try it. You really have to try it. Vodka drinkers out there, you're really going to like it. It almost has a bready, doughy, it's soft. It's a softer taste than I have in most vodkas that I've had. It
doesn't taste like a hospital.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's unique.
It's far from a hospital.
It really is worth checking out and trying. I know you'll be hooked when you do. Now, when you mentioned opening doors and what have you, and the way that, you know, third-party connections, mm-hmm. that's very important in business and a way to grow your business. One of the things that the book has done and the networking group has done, I'll put it backwards, that the networking group has done is open so many doors that I never normally would have walked through, mm-hmm. Whether it be, you know, invited to private clubs, private membership groups.
I like the Groucho nicest Marx quotation from the show with Sandro, by the way.
Was that?
I've used it.
Our co-host here had brought up the Groucho Marx quotation about not belonging to a club that have been invited to.
Yeah.
No, the line is he would not want to join a club that would have him as a member.
As a member, yeah. Yeah. So but that's why I started my own. Nobody would have me, so I started my own.
There it is.
But
sounds right.
It's opened up so many doors and different events. That's how I actually got to meet the folks from Cigar and Spirits magazine. I was invited to an event, another one I couldn't make, but somebody did go, and they ended up hooking us up, kind of a third-party connection, meeting, you know, interviewing Vincente Fox. And it also lends itself to different collaborations, okay? Mm-hmm. Just recently, in case anybody didn't know, I'm a cigar enthusiast. I'm also a member of the Cigar Rights of America. If you're not a member of Cigar Rights of America, go online and join. We need all the help you can get against the FDA and everybody going up against premium hand-rolled cigars.
Absolutely.
But just recently, I was fortunate enough to talk with the president, Mr. Glenn Loop, and we put together a promotional deal for my book that is going to start in the next month or so. Anybody who becomes a CRA member, Cigar Rights of America member, will receive as a thank you gift a copy of my book, Is Your Networking Networking? So we're talking about national exposure for the book, you know, from an industry that I love, okay, and a member of. So it brings about so many collaborations that are
you know, would have never happened otherwise. And it all started with the networking group.
Yeah, not only collaborations, but synergy.
Synergy. That's what I was looking for. Thank you. I'm drawing a blank here, and it's not the vodka, folks. I've only had a wee bit. I might have a wee bit more later.
I think that synergy is a little bit harder to find in my industry.
Mm-hmm. Many.
Or many industries, but I can only speak to mine. In trying to combine, I'll take a step back. In some ways, if you would look at the two verticals on how the company first gets what it turns into vodka and then sells it, mm-hmm. it's almost as if it's two different companies.
Mm-hmm.
There isn't currently an infrastructure beyond us to collect this resource that was hidden in plain sight
mm-hmm.
and turn it into a commodity or, in this case, branded product that has a market specifically. Yeah, there's a market for distilled spirits, but not necessarily ours unless mm-hmm. we make it. So on the fact that we're half recycling company and half like artisan distilled spirits company, we end up having to network in both directions.
Mm-hmm.
And they very rarely have the amount of synergy where mm-hmm. a networking how-to and cigars
mm-hmm.
could work so well, where most of the time I'm with nonprofits on one side,
mm-hmm.
Buyers on the other.
Mm-hmm.
There's very little interchange between the two. One is chronically True. Asking for money, and one is chronically saying no to products.
True.
They don't really interact.
That's a tough one to hit.
And you're walking that tightrope.
Well, it's more like building. It's like building the mesas and the bridge yourself in order to be able to just cross the chasm.
Mm.
I probably said too many words there, but it's just like.
It's a radio show. You can do that.
Sure. Instead of building a bridge, normal metaphor, mm-hmm. it's like you had to build the hills between, like for the bridge to cross in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason we're doing it, going through all that extra work, is that we find it important. The real thing that we're trying to solve for people, not just our investors, but mm-hmm. people, is that for those of us who care about our like livable future, it's always so hard. They always say drive less. In Southern California, that's impossible. Do
it
less.
Is very impossible.
Use less plastic, mm-hmm. eat less red meat. I wanted to be able to create a product for people who are in the course of their everyday lives,
mm-hmm.
within reason, because it's alcohol, are able to use this and do more by using it rather than hurting.
So those out here are doing less, driving less, this is your opportunity to drink more and help more.
Yeah,
drink more. There
Thank you for the pitch. That's exactly right. And so that was so important to me,
mm-hmm.
that if there's just this universal sense of climactic guilt, that to give someone something that they could work with, have fun with, while doing good, was my aim.
So I think that's amazing, and you're taking a product that it really is going to be thrown away as bread. I mean, as far as a source for creating your product, do you think you guys are, you know, got it handled and have got more to go
in terms
of sources?
Got it handled is in the present? No. In the long term, it definitely exists.
Okay, yeah.
So in the next
I know it has a potential.
In the next 2 years, California is going to transition to having a fourth mandated waste stream. So
did not know that.
It starts next year. It was passed in 2016.
Of course it was.
The over the next 2 years, a voluntary reduction in the amount of organics going to landfill is supposed to happen by 50%.
Mm-hmm.
And by 2025, it's supposed to drop from benchmark levels down mm-hmm. 75%. 2022 is when punitive fines will start being enforced.
So there's a huge incentive.
Mm-hmm.
Massive. Recent reports, $15,000 a day at the municipal level.
Yeehaw.
So in the same way that we have blue, gray, and green bins now,
mm-hmm.
yes.
I don't know what the color is going to be, but food waste is going to be a separate one.
Hmm.
And oh, great. Another trash truck's going to whiz by.
Well, I mean, I guess.
Doesn't that leave a bigger carbon footprint? No, I can't say that.
It may or may not. So the reason that we're trying to find... This is why we're carbon negative also.
We're just being silly.
No, absolutely. It speaks really importantly to why the food waste issue is so important to the state of California mm-hmm. and to my company. when all of this stuff turns into methane in the landfill, it's 23 to 40 times more potent.
Yes, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Methane's an issue.
So that massive multiplier is what makes the difference between the CO2 that, say, my boiler creates,
mm-hmm.
same as everyone else's,
mm-hmm.
but why we're capturing more carbon than we put off,
mm-hmm.
At least in equivalencies. So when we find a responsible way at a statewide level to deal with the, I think, over half, I think 60% of all things that go to landfills are these organics.
Mm-hmm.
Not surprising. We waste so much food. It's outrageous.
It's 40% of what we grow.
It's outrageous.
So if you're looking at the largest portion of what goes to a landfill, causing the largest multiplier of what mm-hmm. could possibly happen in the environment, and then find a way to do less harm, that's mm-hmm. what this is aimed mm-hmm. to do.
Yeah, you're definitely, yeah.
But it means that the level of centralization and onus that people are going to pay attention or pay to what I'm doing is about to increase. And the major business innovation behind Misadventure isn't the fact that we get some free commodity and turn it into another one that we have to struggle to sell.
Mm-hmm.
It's that the at least some of the places that have the most bread waste over the next 2 years as this enforcement goes into effect
mm-hmm.
also have liquor licenses.
Okay.
So if I'm able to take their bread that they weren't able to sell in the first place, give mm-hmm. it back to them within a week, it now has an infinite shelf life and a 5x value add. Then, and the fact that if they give it to us, it's outside of the compliance requirements for the entire new state program. We are now the easiest and most profitable thing that they could possibly do.
And it's a win-win for everybody.
Win-win.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Now, since you're talking about that, where can we find Misadventure Vodka in California?
Find us. I have one question after that.
Go jump in.
Well, I was just curious as you have had a lot of misadventures, mm-hmm. and obviously hence the title of your product, which is incredible. Was there one misadventure that finally tipped it over that said, this is going to cause us to create the name of the product, name of your vodka? Was there just one misadventure over another that said, my gosh, we've got to call ourselves Misadventure? Does something come to mind?
No.
No?
Okay. I wish.
If we have one more misadventure, we're going to have to call it Misadventure.
Yeah. But as soon as we had it, every time we screw up, we're on brand. And that has been a wonderful relief. It makes us feel like we did the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And even as a cork, which I think is really cool. I mean, it's not even a screw top.
Yeah, T-top. Yeah, I think you got the one faulty T-top in all of California.
Oh.
the answer to your question right now is in San Diego. And San Diego only, but in 2020, or online through our website.
And what is that? What is that website?
http://misadventure.co. If you write .com, you won't get there.
Okay,
.co.
Misadventure.co.
Yes.
Okay.
So within 2020, though, we'll be in Orange County and LA. If we hadn't gotten our factory open September 10th, and mm-hmm. we'd gotten it open back in July,
now,
I'd hope to already be here.
I was going to ask that question because I was invited down there.
Mm-hmm.
Can people come and tour the factory or your distillery and what have you? So they go to the website, find out where it's at, and call and make reservations to tour.
There's an online booking for the tours.
Beautiful.
And we also have a beautiful private event space.
And that's misadventure.com?
C-O.
.co. Misadventure.co. Okay, excellent.
Thank you very much.
Pretty more efficient. Don't put the M after it.
Right.
Yep. Well, I mean, I'm really excited that we had you on. Everything... And this isn't rehearsed, folks. He just showed up, and we just started talking.
That's it.
Everything that you shared is the epitome of why you network, how you network, the benefits of networking, the connections that are made, and how they come around, you know, full circle. May not be yesterday or tomorrow. You know, maybe a week or a month or a year. But keeping those connections and what have you, it's beneficial, you know, and it ends up paying off. And what impressed me with you and Whit, and whatever, and these guys are the co-founders. I mean, as young as they are of this enterprise, is you know how sharp you are, how attuned you are to the environment, and doing the right thing, and making a quality product, not just another vodka. So I mean, you're doing a couple of different great things. One, you're recycling and repurposing the food product, and number two, you're not just doing it to make a vodka. You're doing it and making a quality premium vodka, which is it's just amazing. It's hitting on both cylinders.
It's a real winner.
Yeah, a winner.
Yeah, thank you so totally. Much, both of you.
So you guys get out there. Okay.
Thanks. Please.
Go on the internet. Order.
Misadventure.co
and get some of this vodka. I know you're going to love it.
And
I know you're going
to
love it.
To your listeners, because we're going to be in Orange County and L.A. in the early part of 2020, if you have any favorite location that you'd like to have me call up and make sure that it's there, just drop me a line on our website.
Excellent. Excellent. All right, well,
that's it. That's it for our misadventure in our
that's
show.
Our, thank you so
that's
much.
That's for our misadventure today.
But it wasn't really quite that much of a misadventure. Sam,
yeah,
thanks so much.
We're hitting on all cylinders.
Look forward to more.
We still
I know you guys are.
9/10 of that bottle left. So.
Yeah. Well, I've got another long drive ahead
the
of me.
Night
so.
Is young.
I'll gladly share with you before I take it with me.
So, hey, thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. Thanks for viewing. And thanks for sharing. You can find Networking for Success on iTunes, Google Play, Spreaker, Spotify, TuneIn, and of course, the most one is YouTube. And we'd love you to like, subscribe, and most importantly, share our show. And we've got one more chapter to do in our book. One more chapter of our book. And we'll be, we have one more after that, right?
One more set.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So check out the book. It's a great read. It's a fabulous.
This is your networking
Christmas present.
It's available on Amazon, Vroman's Books in Pasadena, someone else out there, Barnes and Noble. Yes.
Yep, Barnes and Noble.
Okay.
And many other places. And it's it's a perfect little stocking stuffer. So anyway, thanks for listening, watching, and viewing. Until next time, take care, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.